So, how do React hooks actually work? I think we are all familiar with them. React hooks allow us to use all of the incredible React features without writing a class. This includes state, component lifecycle, and much more. But usually, there are a lot of questions surrounding React hooks. Questions like why can't we call hooks inside loops and conditions, why isn't there a hook for this, why isn't there a hook for that, and so on. If you know the answer to all of those questions, you basically understand React hooks, and that's why we are going to answer them in this video. Let's begin with the by far most asked question, why can't we call hooks inside loops or conditions? In other words, why do hooks rely on call order? The first important thing to grasp is that hooks are all about arrays. Let's try to understand how the useState hook is implemented by reverse engineering it. I will start by quickly creating our own version of React. Let's call it React_x, and it will simply equal a function that calls itself and returns an object that will contain the hook. This is how modules are created. Now let's create the useState hook itself. We know that it is a function and it returns an array containing two values, the state value and a setter function. So let's define them. Let's initialize the state and let's initialize the setter function that will just set the state like this. We also know that we call the useState hook with an initial value, so inside we will access it as a single parameter and let's just set the state to that. Now it's time to test it out. I think we all know that this won't work, but it's very important to understand why. Down here I will import the hook and I will also create a very simple component that will just call the hook inside. This hook will return a counter with an initial value of 1 and a setter function. Down below let's also add a console.log that will simply log the counter value to the screen. Finally, let's call our component because that's all React does. This will just print the counter value once because we aren't really doing much. Now let's try changing the state. Below, I will set the counter value to 2. Let's do that inside an if statement because otherwise, in a normal React application, this would cause an infinite loop. We know that changing the state causes a re-render, so I will simply call our component again, and now we would expect two print statements, the first with the value of 1 and the second with the value of 2. But we are instead seeing two ones. Why is that? The problem is that each time useState is called, it is a different function. The counter value indeed does get changed to 2, but only inside the first function. So, how do we fix this? We need to define state outside of the hook scope. So, let's just move this definition up and see what happens. It still isn't working properly, and that's because there is one more thing to fix, and it is this assignment. This line sets the state to 1, which is what we want, but it does so every single time the hook is called, and this isn't what we want. We want to set it to the initial value only the first time the hook runs. By default, the state value is undefined, so let's just check if it's undefined, and if it is, we will set it to the initial state. Now, in the console, we can see 1 and 2. This is fantastic, but there is one more problem left, and it's not a small one. Currently, we have one state variable, so there can only be one state in the application. However, we need to have access to unlimited number of states. We can do that by changing it to array like this. But now we have to adjust how the useState hook works. In order to use the array, we need an index. Let's set the index to 0 above useState and let's also create a local index variable inside useState that will equal the index. After that, simply increment the index so it's ready for the next hook. Now we are ready to access the state using local index, so let's simply change all of those lines to use it. Let's test it out and see what happens. We are seeing two ones, and once again, there is one more thing we have to fix, however, this time it's rather obvious. The index inside our React is only increasing and it never resets to zero. We can fix that by creating a function called resetIndex that will simply reset the index like this. Let's export it, import it below, and let's call it in between the renders. Now, if we head over to the console, we can see 1 and 2. And that's it for useState. We now have a functioning useState hook. Feel free to play with this by creating multiple states, just remember to call the resetIndex function in between the renders. This useState obviously cannot be used instead of the real useState, because React does many other things behind the scenes. For example, it causes a re-render on its own, but in terms of state management, this is very close to reality. Now, just before we move on, I know many of you are probably wondering why are we creating an extra variable called localIndex. The reason is that if we didn't do that and used the regular index instead, the setter function would use a wrong index, because it runs after the hooks are called. So, going back to the very start, why can't we call hooks inside loops or conditions? Answering this should be very easy now. As you can see, state is just an array and useState accesses this array using indexes. If we called useState inside loops or conditions, those indexes may be different on every render and this would cause each of the hooks to use the wrong state, which would result into application breaking bugs. Since we have now covered useState, it makes sense to cover useEffect as well, because that is the second most important hook and it isn't too hard to implement either. Let's define the function and now the parameters. We know that we call useEffect with a callback and with a dependency array. If there aren't any dependencies, the callback is always called, and if there are dependencies, the callback is called only if the dependencies have changed. So inside, let's create a variable called hasChanged and the default value is going to be true. Below, create an if statement and if hasChanged is true, we want to call the callback. Now, the last thing to do is to calculate the hasChanged if there are dependencies. But in order to do that, we first need to have access to the old dependencies. We need to store them the same way we store state using the array above. So let's just use that array. Let's rename it to hooks, because state doesn't really make sense anymore, and inside useEffect, let's store the dependencies at the very end of the hook like this. Since we are using index once again, we have to increment it afterwards, and now we are ready to access the dependencies above. The last thing to do is to compare them with the current dependencies. They don't always have to be defined, so let's do that inside an if statement. In here, we will set hasChanged to false and we will look for changes. We will iterate through the current dependencies and check whether they are different from the old ones. In order to do that, let's use the forEach method and inside we will provide a function with the dependency and an index. Let's get the old dependency like this and let's compare it with the current one. We may use a normal comparison for this, but it is a bit more precise to use the object.is method, which handles some of the edge cases. We can do that by calling it with the two values and let's store the result in a variable called areTheSame. Finally, if they aren't the same, hasChanged will be true and that should be it. Now, export the hook, import it below and we are ready to test it out. I will call it with a callback that will just console.log useEffect and first, let's try it out with an empty dependency array. It should run only once and that is indeed happening. Let's try calling it without a dependency array. It should run twice because we are doing two re-renders and that's correct. Now, in order to do more testing, I will create another state called name and set it to Thomas. Let's log this here and down below I want to change the name to Jack. But let's do that only if the name isn't Jack, because otherwise, similarly to the start, the result would be an infinite loop. Let's also add this condition, which will make it happen after the counter value gets set, meaning that the name will be checked on the third render. Now, add one more reset index, call our component again, and let's see what happens. useEffect is getting printed 3 times, which is correct, but what I really wanted to do is to see what happens if I add a name dependency. In this case, useEffect runs during the initial render, then the counter value gets changed, so nothing happens, but then the name changes and our hook runs, which is just perfect. Now, after all of this, we have a pretty good understanding of the useState and useEffect hooks. It should be clear that they cannot be called inside loops or conditions because they both use indexes. Let's move on to the next question, which is why isn't X a hook? The X in the question can be something like useProvider, useCatch, useBailout, and so on. The answer is that none of those are official hooks because they don't follow two very important rules. Let's talk about those now. The first one is composition. Composition means that the hooks don't conflict with each other. Just imagine you had two hook calls and one of them would cause the other one not to work. In this case, we say that the first hook would break composition. The second rule is debugging. Bugs related to React hooks should be easy to find. This may appear quite abstract, so let's take a look at an example. One of the often proposed React hooks is a hook called useBailout. The useBailout hook usually looks like this and it simply bails out of re-rendering unless the function provided returns true. In this case, the component won't re-render unless the color has changed. So, why isn't useBailout a real hook? When you think about it, this hook very clearly breaks both the composition and debugging rules. Imagine we use two of those hooks inside a component with two counter values. If the first counter value gets incremented, the component won't re-render because of the second useBailout, and if the second counter value gets incremented, the component won't re-render because of the first useBailout. One of the bailouts would always block the other and therefore break the other. So that's composition, but this hook would also be very frustrating to debug. If a component didn't re-render, you would have to check literally every single of the useBailout hook calls. Just in case you're wondering if there is an existing hook similar to useBailout that actually follows the React hook rules, there exists the useMemo hook. This hook very often offers the desired functionality, but it doesn't explicitly bail out of re-rendering and therefore it doesn't break either of the rules. Now, let's move on to the next and final question. I personally always wondered how can useState be a part of rendering. Rendering is handled by React DOM, but we aren't importing useState from React DOM. We are importing it from React. The answer is that when the useState hook gets called, the call gets forwarded to the renderer using a special field called a current dispatcher. Internally, it looks similarly to this. Where is the current dispatcher field being set? Inside the renderer. So in terms of React DOM, it looks similarly to this. We can see that the dispatcher is set and afterwards our component is called. And that's all for this video. As always, if you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments. There are a few more things about React I would like to cover, so in the next video, we will explore how the React state works internally. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to leave a like and subscribe to see more videos like this in the future. Thank you for watching.